Having your own business sounds sexy, but do you have what it takes to bring your wealth goals on speed mode by becoming an entrepreneur? A good question to ask, since success in business and personal finances do not always go together. I'm Edric Mendoza, and this is On The Money. Today, we are joined by Mark Yu, CFO of Sea Oil and former president of the CFA Society of the Philippines. Apart from his day job, Mark is also involved in advocacies in entrepreneurship and runs a venture capital firm called Novel Capital, Inc. Hi, Mark.
How are you?
Good. Excellent. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
You were saying how some other factors that you need to look at are age, size of business, and culture. Did you want to expound on that?
Factors? It's when you're younger, you have less responsibilities. And going into a business early allows you to take more risks. Over time, when you have kids and you have family, more challenges. You gotta make sure you have enough to pay and cover for the expenses. Mm-hmm. In terms of the culture, I think that will really influence how you run your business. So specifically in the Philippines, we're more social beings. Mm-hmm. A lot of the time, our reputation is quite important. So our ability to separate, for example, personal finance with business finance is affected because of that. Given our social nature, we want to make sure that our business succeeds. So we may tap into our personal funds more than what we'd like, just because we want to save that reputation.
Is there a general guide then for people when they look at that, since that is the culture? How do I keep a safe distance of my personal finances?
I think if any, we'll go back to that two things, your ability and willingness to take risks. Mm. Like any, you should have enough money in the bank, mm-hmm. save for at least 6 months to a year's worth of salary if you want to go in. Knowing that if your business fails, you can always go back to the employment workforce and continue from then on. Mm-hmm. So I think those are really key in terms of determining.
Okay. Yeah. Let's talk about risks. You think entrepreneurs should think about risk, you said, but should be able to deal with adversity. Expound on that.
More often than not, we just focus on returns. And what gets us into trouble is we don't know what to do. We don't know what to do when something wrong happens. And so one of the emotional requirements really is your ability to handle adversity. More than the IQ and the EQ, they say the AQ, the adversity quotient.
AQ.
AQ has to be really high.
I learned something new today, okay.
Yeah. And just to give an example, when we have 10,000 pesos, we're already thinking, how will 10,000 grow to 15,000? That's the return side of the picture. But what's also important is, how do I protect my 10,000 from going down to 5,000? So both numbers are 5,000, mm-hmm. you know, but it's actually a lot harder to gain back the money that you've lost than to protect it in the first place. Mm. Going back to that, going down from 10,000 to 5,000, you've lost half of your money. Going back up again from 5,000 to 10,000,
you have to double it.
You have to double it.
Wow, the effort, that's what you were saying.
So that management of risks mm-hmm. Is quite important if mm-hmm. You're going to go into a business.
Okay, yeah, and you know, you hear about people like Robert Kiyosaki, right? Yeah. They talk in his book, Rich Dad, Poor Dad, he says, you know, building business is the only way to get out of the rat race. But he doesn't talk about the risks very much.
Well, who's going to buy a book
right.
that talks about risks all the time? It's not a sexy topic, but I think it's really crucial. What is risk, really? Risk is really the unknown. And your ability to just think of ways that things can go wrong. Mm. In some sense, you have to bring, I mean, we're all naturally optimists.
Yeah.
Sometimes.
Are we really?
Yeah. I am.
Ben, yeah, you seem like an optimistic guy, yeah. Okay.
But at the same time, you have to think of what can go wrong. Mm. And when I was working overseas, before I did anything, one thing I remember my boss told me was to ask 50 questions.
50, okay.
50 questions and find out 50 answers for those questions. 50 scenarios
that could possibly go wrong.
That could possibly go wrong.
Excellent.
Right? So when it does happen,
right.
you're ready for it. it's no longer a big risk because you know what's going to happen.
You have options prepared.
You have options prepared.
That's excellent advice.
Yeah.
You know, I hear you have a great story about dealing with adversity. Did you want to share about that experience and how, you know, I think the principle you shared is there is one thing, it's one thing to know risk, it's another to actually experience adversity. Tell us about that, Mark.
In 2002, I left a job overseas and I was actually getting paid quite a lot. I really came back here because I wanted to be in Asia. But what I guess came upon was that our company was in financial distress. In 97, with the Asian financial crisis, the dollar, the peso depreciated quite a lot.
Drastic.
And what happened was our debts ballooned to close to $1 billion peso. I mean, we were in quite insolvent.
Right.
So I was like, I should have just stayed.
Okay. Yeah, like in hindsight, right?
Okay. In hindsight. But, you know, the thing is, though, I was here and we looked at the business model. And there was a business, except that we didn't have the capital, or we lost the capital needed. So, I mean, many things could have happened then, I could have given up.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually think that's one of the biggest things. Entrepreneurs, in general, just, you can't give up. You know, keep on trying and trying, and there's many iterations. You won't get it right the first time. And I'm glad that I stayed on. Now we're, I would say, the largest independent oil player.
Congratulations.
In the country. Thank you.
Well done, Mark.
And what was the most difficult emotionally was how do I keep that level of confidence when I deal with people?
Knowing
yeah, at the back
of your mind.
Oh my gosh, you know, I'm pretty much
billion
broke already.
Debt, yeah.
So how, to you to be able to manage, balance that sort of emotional factors is really, I think, very important.
And that shows grit, how well you're able to handle adversity, right?
Yeah.
Which is kind of what we're highlighting. So know your risks, ask 50 questions, but make sure that you're ready.
You're ready.
Yeah.
You just don't know how you will react emotionally. You should try and visualize, if I put in 100,000, if I lost 20,000, how am I going to react? If you say that, you know what, it's okay, then go ahead and do it. But if you know that losing 20,000 is going to make you lose sleep, then you shouldn't do it.
Okay.
I think that's a good barometer.
Excellent.
So can't lose sleep.
Can't lose sleep, right. That's a good... How would you recommend for a person to build that AQ? I mean, like you came into it and you experienced it. Is there something that people considering entrepreneurship can do prior to actually going into it to build that AQ?
I mean, that's a great question, because even now for my kids, you know, I wonder...
toughen them up, yeah.
Yeah, toughen them up, but you're not going to manufacture adversity for them to go through.
Of course.
So you from that perspective, you let them, and you don't try and carry them all the time. You know, let them go through mistakes and figure them out themselves. In some sense, for me, it's a blessing in disguise that I had to go through this, because it's toughened me up.
Yeah.
After that, you know, I can handle
a lot of things.
So I think it's a perspective in life that you don't look at adversity as failure. You have to look at adversity as an opportunity. To learn and become better.
So maybe one way that you're saying that a person can build AQ is to look at their current circumstances and how they're dealing with whatever adversity they have, and make sure they respond well, as you said, and move forward.
Always find a solution.
Always find a solution. Yeah. Excellent. Can you give us specific financial tips so our viewers can also learn from your experience? I mean, concrete ones. For example, I heard that earlier you were talking about delineating personal finance and what you would put into entrepreneurship.
Well, first, where does personal finance end and business finance begin? Right. And really, when you take a look at it, when you put money in as capital into the company, that authorized or paid up capital is where business finance start. Now, sometimes you get tempted because, you know, the company's making money. You'd use some of that company money to do personal things. You really have to put that, you know, clear on that line.
And say don't.
The way you should do that is you issue a dividend.
Okay.
Right? And that's how you transfer money
from business
to your personal account. But always being clear on those two things is important.
All right. Do you believe in buffer funds?
Buffer funds,
or emergency funds?
I do.
Okay.
Anywhere from minimum of 6 months, 2 years. Mm-hmm. It really depends. Mm-hmm. I think you have to assess your ability to get back on your feet. Mm-hmm. How long does it take? Mm-hmm. And that should determine how long you should have in terms of buffer funds.
Does a potential entrepreneur have to consider a different buffer fund, knowing that he's going to be putting money into a business, or is it the same? I mean, say 3 to 6, thereabouts.
I would think it, again, goes back to that idea of control and your value system, your culture.
Okay.
If you're the type of person who, at all costs, I'm going to protect my reputation, mm-hmm. then you should increase your buffer fund.
I see.
Now, if you're the type of person who is okay to cede control, mm-hmm. because there's other ways to put more money into the company,
yeah.
but more often than not, we want to have full control.
I understand.
So if you're willing to cede control to a partner, mm-hmm. then use their money.
So you can help buffer and defer stuff as well.
Yeah.
Excellent. Mark, we're going to have more questions for you. Great stories. We're going to take a quick break right now. Stay tuned. On the Money, we'll be right back. Welcome back to On the Money. Time now for our daily dose of Salve Ses with Salve Duplito.
Kung Fu experts have mesmerized the world for centuries. They practice each movement until their muscles do the thinking for them, until each movement is automatic and precise.
So when the fighting begins, their minds focus on the strategy, while their body flawlessly executes the movements.
Training our children to succeed in business is like that. We have a better chance to succeed if we start while they're young. So every principle is deeply ingrained as they practice over and over.
I recommend 3 activities to do with your children to nurture an acute business mind. First, gardening. Working with the soil, seeing plants grow from a seedling does something precious to a child's mind.
The lesson? You can't rush a seedling to sprout its first leaves, just as you can't rush success.
Second, entertain guests together. Don't shoo them away to play somewhere when your guests arrive at home. Let them stay with you so they can imitate how you do it. Get them to ask the questions rather than to answer your guests' questions. This is the foundation of learning the art of selling. Third, let them pay for goods when you're shopping. Let them count change. Make them imagine how that money, this is now their new seedling, can grow given time and compounded interest. Calculate compounded interest by using your seedlings. You would be surprised how fast they can catch up.
Not all schools teach business math and entrepreneurship, so you have to start at home. The key thing is to have fun. This is how you awaken the entrepreneurship and wealth gene in your child.
Still with us is Mark Yu, CFO of Sea Oil and former president of the CFA Society of the Philippines, to answer some of the questions you sent us via email, Twitter, and Facebook. Mel, what questions do we have for Mark today?
Hi, Edric. We've got quite a few questions for you today, Mark. And the first one is from Twitter from W. Garcia, who asks, what small businesses are good to get into these days? Any tips? Very open-ended question.
Yeah, I know. Very. I would say first assess our market. And a lot of the times we're still focusing on the basic needs of people. So focus mm-hmm. on to retail. But more than just focusing on the type of business to get into, I think it's important to understand, to develop business acumen. Mm-hmm. And I recall I was actually asked to help teach entrepreneurship. And one of the suggestions I gave to them was, more often than not, the teachers would ask the students to come up with projects. Mm-hmm. Think of a business idea and roll with it. Mm-hmm. And I was saying, why don't you get your class of 30 and divide them into teams of 6 and get them to sell fishbowl.
You know, nice.
Put them all in the gym.
Simple, straightforward selling.
Simple,
yeah,
straightforward.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because you first have to learn how to run a business
on a very small scale
and compete. I mean, business, a lot of it's about competition.
Mm. Yeah.
So from there, you can innovate. Mm. I mean, how can I sell more than the guy?
How can I sell better and all that?
Yeah, I mean, yeah. Should I maybe hand out flyers or do delivery?
Right.
And you innovate from there.
That's very creative.
Or maybe I should share the back office or cost goes down.
Yeah.
So this is when your ideas and innovation really start to come in.
Okay, yeah. Well, that's a great idea. Mm. So yeah, those are some good ideas. Find out what the market needs, which is pretty much the basics here.
Yeah.
Food, retail, and great tips.
Develop acumen.
Business acumen. I like that. Yeah.
Focus
more
than so much on the idea.
Yeah.
Not the idea, but the
develop
acumen.
Your skill. Yeah. That makes sense.
Yeah.
Exactly. Okay. The great next advice. Question is from Helen, who asks via Facebook, I've tried to set up two businesses already, but they have failed. I have another business idea. If this doesn't work out, I think I am going to give up completely. The thing is, the bank is asking for a personal guarantee. Should I do it? What are my alternatives?
Should you do it? I would say no. My personal experience is it was stressful when I mentioned earlier that time when we were in financial distress. Mm. Our home was being foreclosed.
Wow, that's tough.
And so can you get through that stress of your personal property being involved in that?
In the business side,
in the business. Wow. So alternatives would be, again, you should be open to getting partners.
Mm-hmm.
Your source of capital are plenty.
Right.
You can also, if you don't want to borrow from banks, borrow from friends. Right. But at the end of the day, I would really want to dissociate the two.
Of course. Yeah. That it gets complicated that way.
Yeah.
Okay. So this person should not try another business.
No, I mean,
if it involves a guarantee, right?
Yeah. If there's no guarantee involved, then try again.
Yeah. You were saying that earlier. Keep trying. Keep going.
Keep trying.
Thank you.
And maybe reflect on the last two businesses you've had.
Mm-hmm. What happened?
What happened? Because the most important thing, the basis of strategy is what you learn.
Mm. Exactly.
Right? From your previous failures, right?
Should have learned from those mistakes.
And if you completely go to something totally new, then you're not able to reap the benefits of what you've learned in those two things.
From the previous experiences.
Mm. So I would recommend that, again, do tweaks because you'll get the formula right. After so many times.
And especially if they have the passion for it.
I mean, that's number one, right? You can't really be in a business where you're not passionate about. People will know that.
The authenticity.
It will see through you.
And exactly.
That's no way to start.
Okay, we have another question now from Jordy, who's a seaman. He sent this question via email. He says, I have $500,000 in savings that I want to use for a business in the Philippines. I'm thinking of going into the franchise business, but I need someone to take care of everything since I can't give up my job. I'm thinking of my best friend since I have no relatives that I can trust. Is there anything I can do to avoid problems in this situation?
I don't think you can avoid problems.
Yeah, exactly.
Well said.
Minimize, maybe.
Or recognize.
Yeah.
And the first question there is, if your friend lost the $500,000, are you still best friends after?
Exactly. You have to professionalize that relationship.
That's a good way to prepare.
And I think that addresses, again, the point I was trying to make earlier, the return and the risks, right? Think of 50 ways this venture can go wrong, and are you going to be comfortable with that relationship that you have with your friend?
Exactly.
And if the answer is no, then you shouldn't do it.
Right.
Now, in terms of... You can write it down like a shareholders agreement. Write out all of the things that can. Let's say another scenario is the best friend does so well, and he says, "You know what? I deserve more."
Mm. Yeah, he wants equity.
Yeah. So what happens in that situation? The worst thing that can happen is fraud. Mm. I mean, if suddenly you find that this person is stealing money from you, I think those ones are very difficult.
Yeah.
But that is really character. Mm-hmm. So when you partner with anybody, be it your best friend, be it somebody else, the most important thing is character.
Mm.
There's actually a saying by Warren Buffett.
Yeah.
He says that you want to invest in companies or individuals that have integrity, intelligence, and drive. And he's saying, if they don't have integrity, you want them to be dumb and lazy.
So that they can't steal from you.
Because you know, that's exactly. I mean, that's a bad combination.
Yeah,
no integrity,
right.
A lot of drive.
And intelligence, are you kidding me?
Yeah.
You'll be wiped out.
Yeah. It's quite difficult to just invest money and without that much more work and think it's gonna grow.
Yeah.
When you invest, you also have to understand, let's say in stocks, mm-hmm. you still have to understand how that company is doing. Mm. You still have to do your analysis.
Right.
So exactly. You can't delegate that responsibility.
Yeah.
Okay, well, we have another question, and this comes from Vic S., who emailed us. And Vic says, my restaurant in Naga City is starting to grow, but I need more capital for bigger space and more staff. Should I pull out my investments in real estate and cash in the bank? If I do, everything will be thrown into the business. Wow. Is that?
Well, I guess the word everything, I mean,
it's dangerous.
Is dangerous.
It is,
Don't sell the farm.
Yeah. And I would first assess, how is the return on this restaurant mm-hmm. versus the return on the real estate? Mm. I mean, at the end of the day, if you're going to sell something, where are you going to put it?
Right.
You know, is it a higher return? So, and the question is, how much higher is it? I mean, if it's only going to, maybe the restaurant's doing maybe 5% better, 10% better than the real estate, you know, you shouldn't do it. I mean, it has to be quite substantial. Mm-hmm. The other thing is, you don't have to sell it. Mm-hmm. You can actually use that as collateral.
Right.
Now, to the bank, because it's quite costly to sell. You have to pay capital gains tax, documentary stamp tax.
Pay off brokers, etc.
You'd lose already about 10% of your money when you do that.
Right.
So look at the assets that you have and figure out, how can I generate liquidity or capital mm-hmm. from the assets that I have?
That's a great idea, using it as collateral. Yep. That would be much easier and less hassle.
Yeah.
And then he'd still keep that asset.
Yeah.
Perfect. Okay, well, thank you so much, Mark. Anyway, send us your questions via email or through Facebook and Twitter, and we'll try to answer them in our upcoming episodes or on our next Q&A Friday.
Right. AQ. AQ. Love that principle.
Yeah.
Excellent, Mark.
Yeah.
Mel, AQ. AQ,
I know. I didn't realize what that was either.
It's important.
Very.
So that's our show for today. I'm Edric Mendoza. Join us again tomorrow for more talk and tips so you're always right on the money.